What I'm going to show you is not necessarily postcards, but postmarks. If you think about Brick Township never had a postmark with the name Brick in it until 1959. And then when the post office named it, they called it Brick Town. Of course, that created another problem. But at one point, from about 1940, 1935, and 1940, up to 1959, we had 14 different postmarks all at the same time, identifying someplace in Brick, but not one said Brick Township. See a map here, you can see all these different ones we have with Osbornfeld, Shore Acres. We even got mail from Chadwick, Normandy Beach, Adamston, Bretton Woods, Matiticoms too, because there were two Matiticoms. Going back, you have Bricktown, Laurelton, Burrsville, again another Matiticom, Point Pleasant, Thorough, Riviera Beach, Herbertsville, Lakewood. So our mail came from all over the place. No one knew, really knew where they lived. Now we'll take a look first at Adamston. The Adamston postmark was in use from 1900 to 1959. This was where it all started at George Adams General Store. They're not all post office postcards. Couldn't find that on a postcard. From there it moved to Tom Woolley's service station. Next are our Bretton Woods. They're in alphabetical order, which is why I go this way. Bretton Woods, 1938, that starts about, I gotta look at my notes. Bretton Woods, 1937 to 1960, it operated. What happened also in 1959, when everything was changed to Bricktown, they consolidated everything, many of these areas didn't want to give up their postmarks, and they continued to use them, even though there were contracts post office, they weren't, didn't have postmasters. This is the first that we know of the Bretton Woods post office at C.A. Osborne General Store on Manteloken Road.
What year is that about?
That's probably in the late 40s. I'm sorry, late 30s.
Yeah, I think it's
the late 30s.
You can read the license plate on it when you have the card, and it's 1939.
That was a postcard. This also is a postcard of the Bretton Woods Shopping Center. There are, I think, four different postcards here. One from the 30s, one from 39, this from the 50s, one from a little later on, and then I took a picture of it. So we have a photograph of it, what it looks like today. From there we go to Burrsville. A little history on Burrsville. It was originally called Matiticom. Then a forge opens up, and the forge becomes owned by the Burr family. You know where Forge Pond is? There was an iron forge on Route 70, went from off of the intersection of Route 88, going west. There's on your right, there's a pond. And that pond was originally a forge. And it was started by a man by the name of Lippincott in 1808. Then the Burr family bought it in 1810. In 1812, they built a dam across Forge Pond. And that dam held back the largest mill pond in the state. But in 1847, after spring rains, that dam broke. It washed away the forge, it washed away 12 homes, a shoe factory, and a tavern.
Why was a mill pond so large, since you don't need a big pond to have a water reserve for a mill?
It was big to begin with as a stream, and it ran all the way back. It ran all the way back to where Brick Lake is today, you know where that is on Cedar Bridge, going towards Lakewood on Cedar Bridge. Okay, so Burrsville is going to change over the years. But this is one of the Burrsville post offices. That was on our book that we did in 99. John and I did another book on Brick, and that was the cover of it. And that was the Haven General Store, insurance agency, gas station, what have you, and post office. Burrsville eventually becomes Laurelton. The Laurelton runs from 1914 to 1959 as Laurelton. Why did Burrsville ever change its name to Laurelton? It was the same place. In 1910, an egg company comes into town, chicken farm. They set up a chicken farm, a large chicken farm. They employed most of the people of Birdsville, but they didn't like shipping their eggs out of Birdsville. Just to give you an idea how large they were, they could incubate 48,000 eggs at one time. You know where, you go out 88 West, there's Brick Hospital on Jack Martin Boulevard, it comes all the way up to 88. If you take from there to Jack Martin Boulevard and both sides of the road, that's the down the area that the chicken farm occupied. And it was called the Park and Tilford Company. They had grocery stores in New York City, but they had their chickens and eggs from here. And they didn't like shipping their eggs out of a place called Birdsville. So they went to the people who lived there and said, can we change the name of this place? So the people got together, and since most of them were working for them, they said, of course we can change it. What do we change it to? Well, they said there was a lot of Laurel in the area, so they changed it to Laurelton. And that's how Laurelton comes about. Today you wouldn't know where Laurelton is. It's the intersection of Route 88 and Route 70. But everybody zips by there so fast, they don't see it. And then we had the Cracker Barrel on Princeton Avenue, which served as a post office for Laurelton. This is kind of a transition post office because it's Laurelton, then it's going to become a brick town post office for a short time. The first family of Laurelton. I put this in, it's a postcard, and this goes a great picture. Horatio, Lydia, Havens. Emma Havens Young on this side, and we have a school named after her, and her daughter Mary Young. I just thought it was a great postcard, so I put it in there. The Matitakong 2 post office. Actually, it was the back of the building. The front was added on later on, but the back of the building, it was down on Princeton Avenue, east of Beaver Dam, east of Midstream Road, comes into Princeton Avenue. The building is still there. From there, we're going out to the peninsula to Normandy Beach. Normandy Beach itself was settled in 1916, or was started. That's when the maps were filed for it. The first two developers went bankrupt. The third developer comes in. He's not doing too well either. But what he does then, he sells off the lots to other builders. And as a result, you get a variety of building there. But one of the things that Normandy Beach had was curbing and sidewalks. Think of that in the 1920s, in that area, that curbing and sidewalks. The first post office is at the very southern end of Normandy Beach in Brick Township. The building is still there today. You come out of Tom's River past 6th Street, the next street up is 7th, and that's where this would be. On your right-hand side, that's Route 37, that brick road, that concrete road is Route 37, which later becomes Route 35 on north. And then we have the next post office in Normandy Beach. And it's stuck between a laundromat and a bakery. You can see it there. And the present post office. I don't know what's going to happen there, if they reopened or not.
I think they did.
Did they reopen? Okay. But some of the people in Normandy Beach get their mail from Mansell Open. Some get it from Tom's River, some get it from Normandy Beach post office. It's kind of a mixed up affair.
And this was damaged during the storm?
Yes. I don't know how much damage was done to it. An aerial view of Normandy Beach. Up here, you can see Camp Osborne, the buildings and roads over here. This is the Sea Bay Park over here. This is where the Thunderbird was built, now the Ocean Club Condominium. And where Ocean Sea Bay Park was, is now Brick Beach. Now the next picture is of Camp Osborne.
Yeah.
Is that the
modern one?
That's 2006.
Yeah, that's right.
Now let's look at it 2012. You may not want to look at it.
I can look at it.
See this building right here?
Yeah.
There it is again.
Oh, God.
Now, was that during the storm?
That was taken in November.
Yep. Yeah, you know what my house was? I'll show you exactly. I was almost on the ocean. I'm all the way up there. But this one house was standing, and I don't know why that one's standing.
Mm-hmm.
It's right next to it. Yep. Everything else is done, except this one, but it's done.
That's still there.
That's where they had the fire, right?
Yeah, that's amazing.
You see the white building over on the side behind the sign?
Yeah.
That's the building, yeah.
Okay.
This is where all the little camp buildings are.
Aren't they sweet? Weren't they sweet?
I do have some other pictures though, but I just want to put that in.
Wow.
To get an idea when you lose things, postcards are a great thing to have.
Oh, they are, yes.
When you come down off the Manitowocan Bridge, you come to Paradise Cove Marina, which now is, what's it called?
Trader Cove, right?
Trader Cove, which is now Trader Cove. But you can see in the back on the right-hand side today is the Forsyth Wildlife Reserve. On the left-hand side is Reedy Creek Reserve, and there are trails going through there that you can walk and travel. Mr. Aaron Elmer, Monmouth County, Lower Squonkam. Where's Lower Squonkam?
Howell,
yes.
Yeah, that's right, Howell.
Everything north of the Tittecock River before 1850 was Howell Township. So, it was all Howell Township, and it was called the Lower Squonkam. Now, this is from 1861. In 1850, it changed. But people are still sending mail to Lower Squonkam. Aaron Elmer was a Civil War soldier. And we see the Herbertsville postmark. Herbertsville gets its first post office in 1884, and it runs through 1938. And one of those early post offices was the Herbertsville post office in this building. This was the Gantt building, Gantt General Store. Rue and Jane Gantt ran it. She was listed as the postmaster there. Do you know where the Herbertsville Firehouse is today? On Herbertsville Road?
On the curve.
On the curve of the road? Well, when you go by next time, this building is on that location.
There's an area in the building.
Very few early postcards of brick in that area. I know this one, we have one of the Methodist Church
and the Parsonage.
And the Parsonage, and that's it. Well, that's probably all there was, really. It wasn't much else. But if you go to the Haven Homestead Museum on Herbertsville Road, we have this Herbertsville Post Office. It was no more than this wide, not that high, had 36 boxes in it, and a little window where the postmaster would go behind and get your mail for you. And we have a sign also from Leonard Herbert, who would go to Point Pleasant to pick up the mail once a week. And in his wagon, he would take someone, if they wanted to pay him 15 cents, he would take him to Point Pleasant and back again on his ship. The last post office in Brick is here at Boxwood Store. Today this is a four-apartment building, but the building is still there. It doesn't look anything like this. But in 1938, they decided to close up the Herbertsville Post Office and move it to Point Pleasant, which was then called West Point Pleasant, and now it came out of that area. Riviera Beach. Rare Riviera Beach postcard. Today it's called the Carnal Bakery. It was originally called Bob's Bakery and Delicatessen. And he ran a post office out of there. And it ran from 1957 to 1967. It worked as a contract post office after 59. The building on the left was originally one of the original houses built in Riviera Beach, and then the store was added on when Bob opened up his bakery shop. But the building was a business too. It was originally a town shop. Shore Acres, Shore Acres Post Office, ran from 1948 to 1961. This is the building on just off of Drum Point Road, the curve in Drum Point Road, and this is the first post office, or the only post office there. And we have in our museum at Haven Homestead Museum all of the apparatus that was in this post office. The scales that they used, the stamps that they used, everything that they had there. and another post office with a hayride, not post office, but with a hayride in storage. And Bricktown. First day issue of a Bricktown post office, Postmarks, 1959, October 1st. That's when all the post offices were consolidated into one post office. And the rest that remained were just contract post offices where they had another business and they picked in mail. When this was done, the mayor thought it was a great idea. The councilman hated it. And in the newspapers of that era, there are bantering back and forth of why it should be called Bricktown. One of the comments was even, well, if you call it just Brick, then it gets confused with Brick Church in East Orange, because there was a post office there. I'm not sure that would happen. But people still sometimes use Bricktown. I saw a business that opened up a few weeks ago used the term Bricktown. And I saw it in Bricktown, it's in Oklahoma. It's not in New Jersey. Now what happened is in 1978, they were going to build a new post office on Cambridge Road. And two naive teachers, myself and Joanne Zabula, went to the postmaster, who was I said the Cracker Barrel would serve as a transition to the church. I mentioned the Cracker Barrel a little later on in that transition period. But this was the post office opening on Princeton Avenue when they set the name Bricktown. So we go in there and we talk to the postmaster. He said, why can't you just have a postmark of Brick? And he said, because the post office decided it's Bricktown and that's what it is. He said, but you know, you don't call Lakewood Town. You don't call Neptune Town. Why call it Bricktown? Well, that's what the post office calls it. So we said, well, we'd like to get it changed. He said, you'll never get it done.
Well, it is Brick Township, so you could look at it the other way and say that the ship got cut off.
Well,
rather than the town head.
And he told us they never recognized political boundaries, which is true. There you go. So I left him with a little story about the postmaster who came out of his office one day, and there was this new worker sorting mail. He was sorting behind his back, under his leg, going into all the bins. And the postmaster congratulated him. You're doing a great job. He said, keep it up. He said, you know, he said, you're very fast, Dad. He said, yep. He said, I'll even be fast when I want to be. So I left the postmaster with that, and we went to Philadelphia to talk to the Metro District area in Philadelphia. And they said, well, it's Bricktown because that's what we want to call it. But we don't recognize political boundaries. Well, we understand that. We don't want to say Bricktown, so that's the political name of it. So our next choice was go to Congressman Forsyth. We go to Congressman Forsyth to explain to me what you want, write out what you want, get a letter from the town council that they support what you're doing, and send it all to him. We did that. He hand carried it down to Reston, Virginia, the Geological Survey of Maine, and they got it changed. So by the time the new post office opened, we went to watch as they took town off of it. We told them, don't put it up, we're going to get it. No, we're putting it up. Okay. So we went and watched as they took town off of the post office. Now, this is one postmark, or one postcard that says, Brick Township.